excited that you're here, that we're all worshiping together. Everyone please stand as we sing 10,000 Reasons. And we encourage you this morning, if you feel led during our praise and worship time with the hymns, to stand as well if you'd like.
We're standing after all, so you can stand too.
Sky. this Tuesday. It's known as November 22nd. Probably one of the most significant dates in history. Most of you might remember November the 22nd, 1963. You might remember, if you were old enough, it was the day that JFK was killed. But to me, and probably several other people, a very well-known, but another death happened that day. A well-known author who I appreciated for years as a young person, a person named C.S. Lewis, who wrote Chronicles of Narnia, the Space Trilogy, the Screwtape Letters, and was a Christian theologian, had passed away on that same day. The most significant day in history, as some recall, November 22nd, 1963. Some of us also remember where we were on a date called 9/11, or where we were when the space shuttle Challenger had exploded, or where we were when Ronald Reagan was shot. And there's most significant dates in history. But to us, as Christians, the most significant date in history is when Jesus died. When he took upon the cross our sins. Did you hear the words to that hymn you just sang? It said, "O glorious crown, O precious cross." You see, to some people the cross looks ugly. We wear them around our neck and that, and it's really a death chamber. It's really an ugly thing to wear. But to us that are Christians, it's our salvation. We gather each Lord's Day around the table to remember Jesus, what he went through, going through the streets of Dolorosa, on the way to Golgotha, to Calvary, to they called it a pile of garbage where they crucified him on, a hill that criminals, the lowlifes of the world, but our Savior did that for you and for me. In the passage of Scripture I quote this morning, Jesus says just before he dies, he says, "Elama, Elama, Ibakhtanath," and it's like, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then he says, "It is finished." And then when he had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit and died for you and for me. And so we're going to spend a few moments, just you and the Lord, and take communion. And when you feel led, you can take out the little piece of bread, and remember Jesus' body, and drink of the cup, and we'll give you a few moments to do that. But let me pray before we do. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you that at the cross it was finished. Several days later, you rose from the grave, and then you ascended into heaven and are coming again. And so, Lord, until that time, we gather each Lord's Day to remember you. So help us at least pause this morning to do that very fact. Not make this an old habit, not make this something that I have to do, but I get to do. Partake of communion with fellow brothers and sisters in the Lord across the world, and to do this in remembrance of you. We thank you, Lord, for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So let's spend a few moments with the Lord and take of the emblems. Thank you.
God smoke the grape unknown of this alone I am sure. My God is love.
Roy Campbell and say, hey, how much does it cost to for the electricity here and that. And you'll say, hey, this is how much we paid last month and all that type of stuff. So there are certain things that we try to be good stewards of your money, but most importantly, it's God's money. And so we try to view it that way. And so every dollar you give, every cent you give, we try to spend it wisely and give to missions. We have several missions we support that do Bible translation, that serve in Asia, in Africa, and here locally. We have a food pantry we support every week. Every week there's somebody from our church that goes to the local food pantry, Lamb's Basket, and serves probably 100 people a week. They had this past week 45 different families, I said families, on a Thursday only. And so they had close to 90 families that I was told last week alone. And it's our turn to help serve this Tuesday. Tuesday's the only time they're open before Thanksgiving. Guess what? That means there'll probably be a lot of people because the people want hams and turkeys and canned goods for their Thanksgiving meal. So if you can help or have some time on Tuesday to do that, that's great. And your offering goes towards that. And we have people that say, hey, I don't have a lot of money in that, but I do have a couple canned goods I can bring in. And we have a couple bins we have out there that you can put your canned goods in. And so what we try to do, and when I tell people about our offering, it's not just about money. It's about people's time, their talents, and their treasure. And so we try to be wise stewards of that. So I'm going to pray for our offering, and then we'll get into our rest of our service this morning. So let's go to the Lord with that. Lord, I thank you for today. I thank you so much for the offering this morning. And may we be good stewards of everything you give us. And may we give back to you how you blessed us so richly around this Thanksgiving time that we remember. We thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. This morning we are in 2 Peter chapter 2. If you remember from last week, I gave an introduction to 2 Peter and saying this was Peter's last epistle, his last letter to the churches before he passed away. But a year before he passed away, before he was crucified upside down, as tradition tells us. And it was written about 64, 65 AD and encouraged the churches. So if you need a Bible, there's one in front of you. And if you need one so desperately, please take it home. We gave it to you. I have a guy that comes in almost every week and asks for a Bible, and we give him one. But one of the caveats that we've been kind of telling him, saying, hey, it doesn't change. It doesn't change. He wants one every week, and I know he gives them away, but we tell him it doesn't change, and then says, hey, if you want to study and be encouraged, come to service in that. And so that's what we've done this morning. And so if you see several missing Bibles, or if you have an extra Bible, like to bring it in, I know a fellow that's been giving them away. And so that's been a good thing, and it's part of our ministry here. And so I'm trying to read my notes and everything, and it's kind of blurry. So I'm getting so old that I need to blow up my notes like another point or two. You know how you used to, as a little kid, you read the 10 points, and now we're at the 12 point? I'm at like 14, and I have bifocals, so I'm still trying to read it. So if that tells you anything. So we need to, basically, to be for something, you have to be against something. There's always these caveats, and people think, oh, I'm for this party, but I'm against this party. I'm for this, but I'm against that. And you'll hear me as a preacher tell you all the time that we are pro-life, we're pro-biblical marriage, and we're pro-Jesus. What does that mean then? That there are people that are against life, that are against biblical marriage, and are against Jesus in this world. This should not surprise you. It should not surprise you that sinners do what sinners do. Which surprises me at times, and sometimes it surprises you, is that Christians do what Christians do. What Christians do sometimes aren't very Christian-like or Christ-like. And that surprises me. I think we need, as a church, to be very Christ-like and to be for a lot of things. And so, if you have something valuable, you are ready to defend it. You are ready to stand firm on the things that you value most. Most of us do not and should not value things. We value eternal things, eternal values. We value our family. It took me a long time when I was in youth ministry to realize people's most precious treasure was not stuff. It was their children and their grandchildren. And so when you're working with people, you're dealing with their most precious treasure, their family. And so we need to recognize that. And so we need to be saying, this is the things that we stand for and we value in that. And when we teach and preach, and I always tell people, when I teach and preach, I want you to be looking it up in God's Word and seeing with it if it lines up to what God's Word says. Because you need to bring your Bible. It's an interesting, I'm not sure if you looked at your bulletins this morning, but in the front it says the B-I-B-L-E, and that's kind of what I'm talking about today, is bringing the Word. I don't know if it's a coincidence or not, if God had that planned, or if someone looked up a message and says, this bulletin fits with what we have with the message today, but I just thought that was fitting. We need to bring the Word to the battle. In other words, you need to be involved in God's Word and bring it to the battle, because there will be false teachers out there. And so in 2 Peter chapter 2, Peter is going to talk about the false teachers that are out there. That's why I always have you look at what the Word says to back it up and say, yes, my preacher is not a false teacher. He has us thinking for ourselves, being in the Word, and saying what God's Word says rather than what his opinion says. And hopefully you see that very well and you can say, yes, this is what we need to do. So we need to bring the Word to the battle. And everything that we do needs to be focused on the message of God's Word. You see, the methods may change. Years ago, I would never have known anything like social media, anything about emailing, anything about live streaming, or any of that. But those are just tools. And those are tools that we use. Those are not the focus. The focus is the message of Jesus Christ and that of transforming lives. And there's a lot of people that want to tell you differently and that are false teachers in the church today that will tell you differently as well. So let's look at 2 Peter chapter 2. And I'm going to read it to you first and then we'll look at it and break it down. There's a lot in here. There's a lot of meat in here. And so what I'm going to tell you after I read it is your homework assignment. You're like, what homework? Yeah, because that's why you have sermon notes and can look back and everything, and that way you can say, your homework assignment is to read this and break it down yourself. Because I'm not going to go verse by verse by verse and look word by word by word and do word study. I want you to be doing that as you're in your Bibles this week and as you're looking at your devotions and that, you continue to do that. Because it reminds me of this story. Someone says, well, I'm not being fed at church, right? And he said, well, I'm not being fed at church. I'm only hearing it once a week, right? It's only 1 hour a week. Well, what are you doing the rest of the week? You need to be feeding yourself. And a person had written a newspaper and said, oh, I'm not being fed at church. I shouldn't go to church because it's not feeding me very well. To the response, an elderly gentleman said, well, my wife has prepared me several meals over our 50 years of marriage. I can't remember a single one of them. All I know is I've been fed and I haven't missed a meal. And then the discussion stopped in the editorial about being fed by God's Word. And I think that's what you need to be doing, is feeding yourself as long as the Sunday worship is to center on Him, and it encourages you to continue to do that as well. And so this is what it says in 2 Peter chapter 2. The Apostle Peter's writing this. It says, there were indeed false prophets among the people, just so there will be false teachers among you. They will bring in destruction, heresies, even denying the master who brought them, and will bring swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow their deprived ways, and the way of the truth will be mauled because of them. They will exploit you in their greed, which with made-up stories. Their condemnation pronounced long ago is not idle, and their destruction does not sleep. For if God did not spare the angels of sin, but cast them into hell and delivered them in chains of utter darkness to be kept for judgment, and if he did not spare the ancient world, but protected Noah, a preacher of righteousness, and seven others, when he brought the flood on the world of the ungodly, and if he reduced the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, and condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is coming to the ungodly, and if he rescued Lot, distressed by depravity, by the behavior of the immoral, for that righteous man lived among them day by day, his righteous soul was tormented by the lawless deeds he saw and heard. Then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and keep the unrighteous under punishment for the day of judgment, especially those who follow the gluttony desires of the flesh and despise authority. Bold, arrogant people, they are not afraid to slander the glorious ones. However, angels who are greater in might and power do not bring a slanderous charge against them before the Lord. But these people, like irrational animals, creatures of instinct born to be caught and destroyed, slander what they do not understand. And in their destruction, they will be destroyed too. They will be paid back with harm for harm they have done. They consider it pleasure to carouse in broad daylight. There are spots and blemishes, delighting in their deceptions, while they feast with you. They have eyes of adultery. They do not stop looking for sin. They seduce unstable people and have hearts trained in greed, children under a curse. They have gone astray by abandoning the straight path and followed the path of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of wickedness, but received a rebuke from his lawlessness. A speechless donkey spoke with human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These people are springs without water, mist driven by a storm. The gloom of darkness had been reserved for them, for by utterly boasting empty words they seduce. With fleshly desires and debauchery, people have barely escaped from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption, since people are enslaved to do whatever defeats them. For if they escape the world's impurity through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, would it be better for them to have not known the way of righteousness than after turning to it to turn back from the holy command delivered to them? It has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and a washed soul turns to its wallowing in the mud. I know there's a lot in here, and you're thinking, Gerard, what the heck did you just read, and how does that apply to our lives and all that? And so, in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, it says, but false prophets also among the people, just as there are false prophets among you. Here's the first point. God creates Satan counterfeits. How can you tell that something is fake? By knowing the truth first. You know how the FBI spots a fake dollar bill? It's not because they studied the counterfeit. It's because they studied that which was true. If you were embraced into the truth of God, you could spot a counterfeit from a mile away. Kids can tell fakes anytime. They tell you the truth, don't they? I've had many a kid come up to me and say, you need to brush your teeth, or, oh, you need to do this, or, and they're very truthful. You can spot fakes anywhere, but God creates Satan counterfeits. Satan wants that to deceive you. There are false prophets, there are false leaders, and so in order for there to be false prophets, we need to have true leaders and leaders of God. In order to be false teachers, we need to have those that defend the Word of God and stand firm on what is going on in our world. And Satan wants us to believe that he does not exist. He exists as an angel of light. And so we need to continue to tell people this is why we're doing it. And it talks about these heresies, an open hand. I mean, doesn't it sound good that a heresy or some of the things are saying, if you believe enough, God's going to bless you with riches and this and that. And that's a false gospel. If you believe enough, you're going to be healthy and wealthy. Doesn't that sound good? But if you read God's word, it's not there. It is not there. It's a false gospel. And so there's people in churches teaching this very thing and saying, oh, you just have to believe enough. And then there's even churches that believe that say, hey, we just all need to get along. That what everybody believes is okay. That having all of these lifestyles and transgender, LGBTQ plus whatever, it's okay. I mean, we all sin. We could look by. It's okay. It's not okay. It is not okay because God's word says that it's not okay. That we are all sinners in need of a Savior, and that we need to stand up for what God says and not for what the world says. We're not meant to be a culture of the world. We're meant to be a culture of Christians that is the church and transforms the world. We do not need to be like the world. And we need to continue to be like Jesus. Jesus is the cornerstone. Jesus is the groom. We're the bride. And we're called to be those things that Christ has called us to be His hands and feet, to be the body of Christ, to be the bride that He's proud of. But so often, if you look around, you see the false prophets, you see the false teachers, and think God is not proud, and that we need to take a stand and be firm. And why is this powerful? In some ways, we have this unseen spiritual battle going on. When was the last time you heard the word demons talked about? And that there's a demonic force that happens in our world. The spiritual battle. In Ephesians 6, chapter 10, it says, put on the full armor of God. Why? Because there's a battle going on. There's a spiritual battle going on in our world. And if you do not see it or have not seen it, you have not turned on the news lately. There's a battle that divides us. And Satan wants to divide us. He wants to deny that he even exists and say that it's okay. That this person will deliver you. This party will deliver you. The government will save you. People will save you. The culture will save you. And if you're against it, you're evil, you're bigoted, and you're this or that. And this is wrong. We as a church need to say this is wrong. We take people from where they are to where they need to be in a relationship with Him. God creates beautiful things. And if you don't believe it, look at the fall colors. Satan counterfeits and takes that which was once beautiful and destroys it. And makes it ugly and not worth it. And we need to continue to do that. And Satan takes those things and makes them popular. Songs are popular. Culture is popular. And culture is what you teach and believe and all of this. And so we follow this and think that truth is feelings. If you're led by your feelings, you can get yourself in trouble. Because we think, oh, today I feel like I'm a boy. Or maybe I'm a girl. Or maybe I'm an animal. I mean, I don't know if you've read the news lately, but there was a girl that thought she was a cat. And so the school's allowing her to be a cat in school. I didn't know why. And it's just sad that we have a culture that thinks that way. And we have a culture that thinks in a different way that is not godly and does not let you think of the things that are logically make sense. To me, it logically makes sense that we follow Jesus no matter what. And that we love people. But people say because we're against a few things, and they cite all of those things, I'd rather people know what we're for. We're for Jesus. We're for loving people. We're for taking people from where they are to where they need to be. We're not for embracing the culture, but being countercultural and saying that of which we want to be is the bride of Christ. Does it mean that we always get our way? No. Do you let your kids always get their way? No. Grandkids? Well, maybe. But that's when nobody will stop grandma from swallowing them. But we recognize that. So we recognize that God creates, Satan counterfeits. Here's the second point I want to give to you today. Is you can make it. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4 says, "For God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them out and committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until judgment." God cast those who were rebelling out of the spiritual battle. That there are fallen angels, there was a war in heaven, and there was no salvation possible for them. They thought that they were better than God. They wanted to rise up. Satan wanted to rise up. Lucifer wanted to rise up and to be like God. And so we recognize the spiritual battle that happens around us. And it talks about the fallen angels. Not only in our passage it talks about fallen angels and what was reserved for them, but it talked about Noah and the flood. And it talked about Noah and the flood. And you know that in almost every culture, every different religion, there's a flood story. So I firmly believe it happened. And I have faith that Noah happened. And so we see this idea that Noah was saved, him and seven others were saved from the flood. Because in order there to be be consequences for people's actions, there has to be a punishment. And that's what happened with the flood. But there was also salvation for those who did right. Noah was known as a righteous man, and so was saved because of what he was done. He's a preacher of righteousness. And yet, I sometimes feel like Noah, don't you? Noah preached and preached and preached, and no one responded to the message. The only response they had to the message was to reject it. And for those of us in small churches and preaching in small churches, we feel like Noah at times. We're like, okay, who's going to respond this Sunday? Anybody? Okay, I'm going to just keep preaching. I'm going to be like Noah, preacher of righteousness, keep preaching. Because people can either accept or reject the message. And then there's the idea of Sodom and Gomorrah. We're very familiar with the Sodom and Gomorrah. And it's not very PG or G of what happened in Sodom and Gomorrah, was it? I mean, they did the sexual acts. They did whatever they wanted to. And the only righteous person there was Lot. And God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah right there. And God sent two angels to rescue Lot. And Lot moved his family from Sodom and Gomorrah. And we see this whole idea of perversion happening there. Have you seen these salt shakers? Salt pepper shakers that had Lot and then Lot's wife? Guess which one Lot's wife is out of the salt pepper shakers? Salt. Why? And it has her looking back. I love those salt and pepper shakers. I wish I had a pair just to show you because it has Lot as the pepper and Lot's wife because she looked back and turned into salt. Because she didn't have the faith to keep going forward and that. So there's this perversion and rebellion. And when you rebel against God, there's going to be a punishment for it. Sodom and Gomorrah felt it instantly. And some of us want the punishment right now. We want, we're sometimes like James and John in the New Testament. God, bring down the thunder! Come on! These people deserve punishment right now, right? We see everything's going around in the world and we're thinking, like we're like James and John and thinking, come on, destroy these people and that. And that's when Jesus kind of intervenes and says, it's not for you to do. It's not for you to happen in my time. And if you read that about James and John and the sons of thunder who wanted to call down and all this, you see all of that. And we see that. So the rebellion, the despised authority. And then in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 10, it says this. Bold and willfully, they did not tremble as they blasphemed the glorious ones. Where our angels greater in might and power do not pronounce a blasphemy judgment against them before the Lord. We need correction for redirection. When you were corrected as a kid, you know why you were corrected? It's so that redirect your behavior so you would no longer do that. You know one of the scariest things I ever heard as a kid? Was these words, go get me the belt. Or go get me something to beat you with. And one time I brought back
like paper, don't do that. Because they'll want you to bring back something different. But this whole idea of correction. So these angels knew not to blaspheme against the Lord. Even the great angel Michael knew not to get in the debate with Satan. If you read Jude, he says, I'm not getting in this debate with you about Moses' body. I'm not. And they knew not to do that. They knew to be wise and to choose their battles wisely. And maybe that's what you need to know, is to choose your battles wisely. This morning in the foyer back there a couple weeks ago, I talked about conflict resolution. Matthew 18, if you have someone that you have a conflict with, you're either going in the conflict, coming out of a conflict, or you're in the midst of a conflict right now. There's a little resource called Being a Peacemaker, and it talks about these scriptural steps to take when you're in a conflict with somebody. We're getting ready for Thanksgiving, right? What usually happens around Thanksgiving time? Families gather, right? Guess what? You might have that one family member you're in conflict with. Maybe you need this resource this week before you get into it at the Thanksgiving table. Because so often it could be politics, so often it could be something else, and it could explode. And maybe you say, oh, yeah, I'm glad my church gave me this about being a peacemaker and what the Bible says. Because if you have a conflict with somebody, you need to pull them aside. And then if they won't listen, take someone with you. And then take them to the church, and then go from there. So this is a good resource that will help you. Another tool for your pocket. So we have those out there, including some other things. So I just wanted to let you know that. And in our passage, it also talks about this idea of pride. Angels and demons. Do you know anybody that's proud this morning that has this pride? Do you know anybody that thinks they're better than anyone else? It's happened throughout history. We have lots of people that think they're better than anybody else. Well, I'm better than so-so. I make this much money. Or I'm from this area. Or I'm from this area. Or I'm even getting into something as silly as I call it, skin color, that. And they have racism. It's really sad, isn't it? And the pride is our downfall. And I think it's probably the number one sin. Is we think we're better than anyone else. That's what Satan did. And he tried to deceive Eve and say, oh, you can become like God. God doesn't want you to do that. What's that? Pride. And then this idea of public, to revere in daytime. You see, it used to be at nighttime. We used to call it the Lady of the Night. Prostitutes used to be called the Lady of the Night because what happened in the nighttime was evil. But now people just parade it around any day, all day long. Hey, this sinful lifestyle. Are you sick of some of the commercials? I'm like, when I was a kid, I don't remember hearing about sex and all this type of stuff. And now they blast it all over all the time. TV, they don't matter with kids. It used to be after 8 o'clock at night, they wouldn't have certain ads and that. And all of this type of stuff. But now they just broadcast, hey, let it all out. Broad daylight, disguise in the age of light. It's good, and all that. And don't put it in a good context. Because marriage, we recognize, and sex is reserved for marriage. But we say, oh, if it feels good, do it, do this, do that. And it's just sad that they do it in broad daylight and say, oh, this is what's going on. And then the prophets. It profits one another. The heart's trained in greed. We always think it's about me, me, me. Don't we? We have this, have to have correction to redirection. And then we see this, fourthly, maybe you have a family member that this happens to, that some people self-destruct. What do I mean by that? Well, in 2 Peter chapter 2, the end of it says, some waterless springs and mist driven by a storm, for them the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved. The boast of fury. They promise freedom, and they forget the knowledge of our Lord. For it would have been better for them to know the way of righteousness than to turn back the holy command delivered to them. And then there's this proverb. It says, when a dog turns to its own vomit, and the pig, after washing itself, returns to wallow in the mud. What do we see in here? We see pride, the boast of folly. We see power, loud boast of folly. We see pleasure, that of passions enslaved. And then we see this pathetic thing of a dog returning to its vomit. You ever see that? It's sick when an animal gets sick and then all of a sudden it's eating its own vomit. You ever see that? Don't do that! You're taking your pet away. It is gross. And a pig in the mud. And you ever been around pigs or a pig farm? They stinky and smelly. The only thing I think pigs are good for is bacon. And I always tell people when we were at our men's meeting, for breakfast, I'll say, I believe in love at first sight. And they're like, what? I've seen bacon. And this whole idea of pigs and mud and slinging mud, it's just gross and disgusting. And yet, we see people like that who self-destruct. And no matter what we tell them, we say, stop that. They don't. Even around Thanksgiving, we might have a family member saying, hey, why are you listening to me? You need church. You need God. And we can even take a 2x4, I don't suggest doing this, and smack them aside the head, and they still won't listen. They have to find out the hard way, don't they? And sometimes people will never find out the hard way. You know, there's a difference between Judas and Peter. Judas self-destruct. Peter got a second chance. Judas totally denied Jesus and betrayed him. Peter denied Jesus, but got a second chance. Years ago, there was a fellow in my youth ministry, and the parents wanted me to talk to him to change his life around him. And only he could do that. But there was this one place I took him to. And I've taken my son to this one place. I've seen several places around like this. There's this one place in Ohio, in northeast Ohio, that you pull up on one side of the road, there's a prison. And guess what's on the other side? A church building. So we pulled up there. I pulled up to the church parking lot and just had a little conversation with him. He says, this isn't going to be long. This is the conversation I'm going to have. And his name was Paul. And I said, Paul, this is a conversation I had. I've heard you've done some wrong things, and I want you to know you have a choice in life. Either you continue the way you are, you end up in that place, in prison. Or you continue on the ways of God and be loved by a loving church family. And the choice is yours. You have to make that choice. Every one of us comes to that same spot in life, in crossroads of life, where we have to make that choice. And we have to find out, how are we going to be rescued? Noah got an ark. Lot got angels. Balaam, in our story, got a talking donkey. Can you imagine that? He didn't even was shocked about the donkey was talking about back to him. Just the donkey talked and said, hey, smarten up. He's like, yeah, but listen. He didn't say, oh, talking donkey? No, he's like, talk to it like it's nothing. It happens every day. So Balaam got that. Peter got a second chance. How about you? What are you doing with your life? Is God giving you a second? He does give you a second chance. But what are you going to do with it? So we're going to sing a concluding song. Maybe this morning, you want that second chance. And say, Gerard, I need that second chance. I believe that Jesus died for me. He rose for me. He's coming again. And I want to put my faith in him and be baptized in him. Maybe that's you. Or maybe you're saying, Gerard, I believe this. I just need prayer. I'm going through a lot. Or maybe you're looking for a home church that's trying to do the right thing. That's what we're trying to do right here. Our little old church is trying to make a difference in the world. And being pro-Jesus, being for him in all things, no matter what. And continue to do that. So this morning we're going to sing. And if you have a decision, won't you come as we stand and sing our concluding hymn. Hymn number 463, 463. Thank you.
Father God, I thank you for today. I thank you, Lord, for all things. I thank you for Jesus. Help us in this time to be your hands and feet to a world that desperately needs you. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. You have a good week, and you have a good week too. Don't forget, we have these out in the back.